So first, let me start thanking Fernando for this kind invitation. It's a great pleasure, privilege, to talk about our research or our ideas in general in this distinguished audience with ministers, presidents, princes, and of course, distinguished colleagues all over the world. I want actually here to summarize two, three aspects of our thoughts in renewable energy. One is the solar energy in particular. The other one is, of course, the aspect of converting the solar energy into different forms of useful energy. And I know I'm educated as a physicist, but I know that in this audience there are many sitting here coming from particle physics and atomic physics and even fusion, nuclear fusion. We had jokes about tokamak in the first day. And indeed, I'm a big fan of nuclear fusion. And I have even a machine which works. Which works perfectly. My tokamak works. We have to communicate this to the Prince of Jordan. There is one which really works. It's in a safe distance. It's 150 million kilometers. So there is no risk of explosion or Fukushima type of catastrophes. We just have to take its energy and do our work here in this planet. And what about the peace aspect? So I will really invite everyone to visit this homepage. We had last year a very interesting and I would say highly impacting conference in Istanbul, originally initiated also with my good friend Walter Cohn together, so he personally was there, several others. And indeed, the idea of a distributed network of solar energy plants is completely democratic. There is no way that some country can forbid another country to use or to access the solar energy. Therefore, it is intrinsically, in its own logic, anti-imperialistic and democratic. So in that sense, it is, to my definition, a real opening possibility for future. Since we had a very nice banquet yesterday, and also the time is a little bit progressed, let me entertain you a little bit about the stories maybe related to solar energy, and maybe some of you will pick up some messages when you get back home. Interestingly, we have heard also great talks on this climate problem, and the CO2 is indeed rising. So what do we do? And as an experimentalist, we have to find a practical solution, and some people talk about CO2 sequestration. This is basically supercritical CO2 pumped down into the rock beds or even deep sea. The problem in that case is twofold. The first fold is it's very expensive and it's useless CO2 there. Second, well, we had this before, actually, somewhere in Africa, there was a burp of a CO2 which killed thousands of people, so it's not so trivial when indeed these things could escape in a rock bed and it will be dangerous for the outside. The more, let's say, reasonable suggestion is, of course, how to recycle this CO2. And in that sense, another Nobel Prize Hungarian, George Ola from USC, he wrote this book, 2006. It's beautiful. You see the CO2 recycling into methane or methanol. He's actually titling his book with methanol economy because methanol is liquid. And actually, this is not the sugarcane alcohol, so for the theoretical physicist, we have to maybe say that you shouldn't drink this. It makes blind. But it's a very nice substitute for a gasoline. However, methane is also there. This is the Russian gas we are receiving, or we are still receiving from Russia. We will see what will come out. Solar energy, sorry about this, its language is in German. Solar energy has, of course, an enormous potential of several tens of thousands of terawatt and even a very few fraction of this we can utilize that will solve all our problems. Interestingly enough, there is an anti-correlation between people using solar energy and their solar irradiation. We know Germany has now built up a capacity way above 20 gigawatt, and this is in some parts even really dominating. And if you look to this diagram, actually Germany has much less solar capacity than, for example, Italy, or North Africa, or South Turkey, or South Spain. And interestingly enough, Germany is apparently doing either a risky move or all other countries are missing something. And we know that Southern Europe is in most of the cases in deep trouble with the foreign account balance. And if you look to the account balance sheet, for example, for Italy, you can immediately see the biggest block there is the energy imports. So maybe you should start thinking about that. I will just recapitulate here a couple of nice pictures from this book of my good friend John Perlin from Santa Barbara. So he titled his book, From Space to Earth, The History of Solar Energy. And indeed, solar energy has been in this planet before. I mean, this 1878 in the World Exhibition, people always remember Eiffel Tower, but this machine was also there. And this machine was a solar concentrating steam engine. It was displayed there. This is actually a quote. You should see here the date, 1892. So this is fairly some years ago. At that time, solar heat was indeed used and even sold in the US. You see, no care, no worry. So this reflects actually the sun's heat. And indeed, it saved apparently a great deal of money. And this fellow should be acknowledged here also, this Frank Schumann. He must have been a very inventive fellow in Philadelphia. In 1907, this is the number here, in 1907, he actually made a solar engine with which he was pumping water and using in agricultural use. And today, if I travel, for example, if my own home birth country, Turkey, that people are still using gasoline and this kind of water pumping with gasoline in places where there's abundant sunshine. I'm sure in Africa, every one of the delegates from Africa, they can eyewitness this in their own home country. It's actually a shame. I mean, we had done this in 1907 and apparently forgotten. So this is even a power plant, they did it. Today, of course, we can do better than that. Stirling engines can be applied, etc. And we know that in Spain, you can even have very large power plants using the solar heat. The second revolution actually came from the solar photovoltaics. And there are three people have to be mentioned, Fuller, Chapin, and Pearson. And they indeed used silicon, which is the main technology today, to make solar energy into electricity. And this is the title of the book of John Perlin, because the first use and the immediate use was in the satellites. Today, of course, every satellite is powered by solar energy. And hopefully one day it will come back to Earth. So our institute is dedicated to organic semiconductors. Let me just say a couple of words on that. And we are working in different fields of solar cells or CO2 recycling and also some bio-organic electronic devices. And we are utilizing also the institute for making spin-off companies. Semiconducting polymers, of course, are famous materials because they can be combining the semiconductor properties with the polymer or processability of chemistry. So in that sense, I also made my metamorphosis from physics to chemistry. I studied physics, but I'm now a professor of chemistry. Somehow it's not bad. I recommend that. And these solar cells, for example, can be produced, these plastic solar cells in long rolls. And this gentleman here inside me, this is maybe some of you recognize him, is Christoph Brabetz. He himself is now a big professor in Erlangen. So our recent contribution in this field, for example, we could make really one micron thick solar cell, which can be shrunk and stretched. And these things are really robust and flexible. And the weight it's interesting. Normally, solar cell people always plot here the watt per square meter or square centimeter, which is the efficiency of a solar cell. And we plotted in this paper, so watt per weight. And I was actually thinking it's more curiosity. But it made a big impact because especially space agencies like ESA, NASA, and Air Force, they were highly interested because for them is weight is more important than anything else. Because space, you know, in space there's a lot of space, so this is not the problem. You can also use textile integrated technologies and, for example, uniforms and gadgets. They are already in the market now coming in. What I actually support these days, a very nice project of my good friend Arvid Hübler from Chemnitz. He's a printing specialist, and we were thinking about the material, which plastic we should use, etc. And he said, why don't we use the good old paper? Because we know how to print on paper. This is the oldest technology. So we are now developing this technology, directly printing on paper, these solar cells. It can be fairly cheap and maybe have an impact in developing countries in the first hand. If you want to know more about this, this is our original patent 92 on this bulk heterojunction solar cells. I don't want to go into these details. This is the definition of a bulk heterojunction where an acceptor and donor material are intermixed together in one system. There is also a book for the students and younger scientists. With Alan Heger, we wrote a book about this semiconducting polymer. This is a teaching book which came out in Oxford texts. So what's the next challenge? Next challenge is indeed the solar energy conversion into chemical energy. Why do we need that? Because in like every other renewable energy, solar energy is what we call supply-driven energy forms. That means sun shines or wind blows when they want and not when we want. So in that sense, we have a problem. If we want to use the energy which we convert later on, we have to store that energy. And if we want to use it in a different place, we have to transport this energy. So this is a big challenge today. Transportable fuel, for example, like an oil or gas, would do this job. So we have to convert solar energy into kind of a transportable artificial fuel. And this is also a slide I took from Solar Fuel, our spin-off company. It's also in German, sorry about that, but you see here in June 2009 the fluctuations, the real fluctuations of power in the wind net and transpower net of E.ON. This is the German supplier. And if you look at one of these peaks, look at the numbers. I mean, the numbers are important here. You see 6,000 megawatts. 6,000 megawatts are coming in within a couple of minutes. Now, this is a challenge. Even the best grid, even the smartest grid, cannot accommodate that kind of fluctuations. And if you look and integrate this, for example, peak here, you end up in 80 gigawatt hour capacity of storage we need. And this is more than the entire world production in batteries. So people are working in batteries, are very highly welcome. It's important for many applications, but for these kinds of energy storage, it's more or less insufficient. The same thing, of course, for photovoltaics. And the idea is, why don't we make an artificial fuel? And for making an artificial fuel, we need carbon. And where do we get the carbon? We have heard here, we have even too much of it. It's causing trouble, so we have to take indeed the CO2 and recycle it. So this will solve the two problems of CO2 and renewable energy storage at one step. Is it possible? Where is the proof of existence? This is always the industrial people asking us. The proof of existence, of course, is we self, because the entire nature is based on this conversion of solar energy into chemical energy. Interestingly, scientifically, there is a critic to point out here. Everybody works in water splitting. However, there is one important cycle which is called Kelvin cycle, which is the CO2 conversion, catalytic conversion into some kind of higher carbon hydrides. That has been neglected a lot, apparently. So we can use photochemical, electrochemical, biochemical reduction. And this is the normal C1 chemistry. In every book, you can see that. And the best way is, of course, to get to the final, this methane, because we have already an infrastructure here. And now coming back to this book of Ola, it's indeed very nicely described why it is making sense to use this CO2 recycling. Is it possible? Yes, it's a known technology. Actually, we are doing this in an industrial scale too. We can take and electrolyze water, CO2 capture, and make a reaction and heat actually getting the methane. And there was a spin-off company who moved to Germany now, is making big action. This is E2 gas. They were created in Linz as solar fuel. And we did first small container, 10 kilowatt, and now they are doing the big megawatt scale of systems with Audi Corporation. Audi had this interesting idea, actually. He said, if a car uses methane, which is coming from recycled CO2, then it should be CO2 neutral. That's correct. So in that sense, if a car is driving by methane, and if this methane is coming from the recycled CO2, that would be also a sustainable cycle for future. This they call e-gas project or power to gas. Another interesting approach is, of course, from Michele Aresta from Bari. In that sense, this fellow actually said CO2 is much more than a fuel. It's actually feedstock, carbon feedstock. We can do many, many valuable chemicals out of CO2. Why don't we use this? And we can use CO2 and solar energy to make a real chemical industry without having this petrochemical industry. So we work a lot in this field. I don't want to go into detail, but it's indeed possible to make these things happening. My final comment is actually on the general, what we heard also, general issues. And also the peace aspect comes here quite high. Many people predict that there will be a convergence of multiple crises in the next decades. And all these crises, of course, will create conflicts, especially energy conflicts and demographic shifts and economical collapses, climate refugees, etc. And I believe it could be an interesting contribution of solar energy to each one of these items in crisis. So maybe we need a global solar Marshall Plan in future, which these words I thank again for the nice conference. Thank you for your attention.